Ember Gaming looking for a lot of push power. Couldn't do it. Great team fights overall by SKT.
Yeah, but now we're going to hand it over to our panel of experts to break down that game.
Thank you, Atlas. Pretty solid game there for SKT. One half of the desk was correct here. Let's dive into it, though. Let's break down some pretty high-level play there by both teams.
Oh, I don't let Spawn off this easy. They're going to get crushed. It's going to be one-sided, huh?
Hey, I said it was going to be one-sided.
You said EDG.
Do you have a moment to talk about the Church of Easy Hoon?
I'm not even going to talk about that. I'm just going to say that when we threw up yesterday what the weakness of EDG was, if there could possibly be one, I said pick bans. And you guys all called me insane.
Yeah?
That was the worst pick ban phase I have seen coming through in a long time. I actually don't understand at what point of the game they thought their composition was stronger.
Yeah, I don't understand the Tristana at all.
Well, you could say that their comp was terrible, but the SKT composition was one of my favorite comps of all time. It's 5-threat composition. Each champion on that team is a huge threat to any team. You got knockup CCs, a lot of damage, and a thing that goes unnoticed is the fact that these champions have really cheap power spikes. Rumble needs a Haunting Guys and a Sorcerer's Shoes. Gnar, on the other hand, you know, he might need a Warmox, might need a Randuin's, maybe even a Maw. A Lulu, by the time that she finishes her Athene's Holy Grail and Deathcap, Vlad's already sitting at 3 items. His item spikes are Will of the Ancients, a Abyssal Scepter. It's really cheap, so they can fight really early. And Tristana needs 2 items, while Kalista only 1. Force these super early fights when EDG cannot even contest at all, and they try to contest, and look at what happened. They got rolled over.
Yeah, but that's not the EDG we're used to seeing. We've seen EDG fall so far behind. They'll give up 4 dragons. They'll give up the first Baron and then fight you at 45 minutes in the game. That EDG that we just saw then realized that their team comp got outclassed, and they didn't pick for the late game. Jinx was available. Deft is, and I will stick by this. Bang had a fantastic game, but that is a game. Deft is still the premier AD carry, and if he was on Jinx, they at least have something to fall back on.
I feel like also that was a testament to how well Kalista was played in this game. Like, if anybody wants to learn Kalista, this is the game to look out for, and this is the player to look out for.
Yeah, Bang's Kalista is a little different than what we're seeing in NA, because what he does is he maxes Q first, and he's constantly throwing a Ren stack on a minion, possibly two, Qing through it, and it does enough damage since he's maxing Q to go through it, and then it hits Deft over and over again, and then he just pops the Ren, and it's so much damage because of the damage of the spear on top of it. And we're seeing his lane partner, Annie, walk up, throw the stun, so he just basically lines it up so he can knock it down after, and he gets the Sentinel passive on top of it. It's really good, because in NA, people are maxing E still and building Runan's Hurricane. People eventually were like, all right, let's stop building Runan's first, get a BF sword, but then they didn't adapt the skill order from swapping it over from E to Q. You should be maxing Q first if you're going for the BT.
Clearly a lot of passionate discussion to be had about this game. We'll get right back into it in just a moment. We've got Shox at the interview lounge for a word with a member of the victorious SKT.
Thank you very much, guys. I'm joined here by Bengi after that victory from SKT over EDG. Congratulations, Bengi. And we heard you saying in the features beforehand that you were very excited to go up against Klerlov and respect him very much. Do you think that you were able to pressure him out in this game, that you had a better game plan and a better game?
그 예전 인터뷰 때 클리어러브 선수를 되게 존경하고 선수로서 되게 존중한다고 말씀하셨었는데 예. 어떻게 이번 경기 때 본인이 좀 더 좋은 활약을 펼쳤다고 생각하시나요?
일단 제가 뭐 그렇게 활약한 것 같진 않고 이번 판에 팀원들이 잘해서 그 제가 활약할 수 있었는데 탑에서 그 기회를 놓친 것 같아서 아쉬워요.
I think we won this game because of my teammates. I had my chance at top, but I kind of blew it. But overall, I want to thank my teammates for the win.
Yeah, you guys all played very well together. After the finals where Tom did so good for you guys for SKT, how did that affect your mindset coming in and then ending up being selected for this tournament with all the experience that you have?
그 MSI 오기 전에 롤챔스 결승전 때 톰 선수가 되게 좋은 활약을 펼쳤었는데요. 그때 그 톰 선수의 활약 보면서 좀 MSI에 올 때 좀 동기부여 됐었는지 좀 물어보고 싶네요. 네.
질문 다시요.
톰 선수의 활약 보면서 네. MSI에 올 때 좀 네. 본인에게 동기부여가 됐었는지.
일단 결승전을 올라갔는데 경기를 못 뛴 거에 대한 약간 아쉬움이 좀 커서 이번 MSI에 좀 좋은 모습을 보여줘야 될 것 같다는 동기부여는 됐는데 그래도 여전히 아쉽네요. 결승전에 못 뛴 거.
I was motivated by Tom's play during LCK finals, but I still hope that I could have had my chance at the LCK finals. Yeah.
Yeah, well, you've definitely shown what you're worth here already. 2-0 for SKT today, and you guys are still playing TSM in the last game of the day in front of their home crowd favorites. After what you've seen from TSM today, how big of a chance do you give them that they can beat you?
이제 오늘 마지막 경기로 TSM과의 경기가 남았는데요. 또 오늘 TSM의 경기력 봤을 때 TSM이 SKT1 팀을 어떻게 이길 수 있을 것 같으세요?
일단 저희 오늘 일단 분위기가 좋아서 TSM한테 TSM도 잘하는 팀이라 질 수도 있지만 지금 분위기로는 잘 할 수 있을 거라 생각합니다.
I think our team is playing great today. Even though TSM is a really good team, today I think we have an upper hand.
Today they have the upper hand. We will see. That is the last game of the day. Thank you very much, and we're going to move back over to Dash over at the desk.
Thank you, Shox. Now, there was a lot of discussion about which substitutes SKT should be bringing along to MSI. So, Zyrene, I want to hit you up for your thoughts on that.
Yeah, at first, I was really surprised that they were going to bring Bengi, considering the 3-0 performance that we saw Tom have alongside Easy Hoon in the LCK finals. I thought it was actually kind of short-sighted to bring Bengi instead of Tom, because I thought Tom needed the international experience before Worlds if they were actually, like, being full on with that commitment to bring him into the team. But then Bengi's been stepping up here. Bengi's been showing that his Rek'Sai is still very relevant on the Cinder Hulk patch, and he's able to make these aggressive moves and carry, even be relevant in the late game. So I think that I have to rethink my entire, like, thought process behind that, because Tom, you know, he does have some tilty moments, and I think that Bengi being able to keep his cool, it shows that they brought him because they're here to win this. They aren't here to give Tom experience. They're here to win this tournament.
I think you also have to rethink that Easy Hoon is pretty damn
good. Dude, the Immortal, he didn't
this
die.
This guy is
he is very good. He's very good. And this kind of, this plays into what I want to go into next, which is that even with this organization having multiple subs and therefore many different rosters that they can throw onto the field, they seem to have pretty stellar communication. These guys do not miss a beat no matter who they're playing. With that, I want to jump into our replay of the final fight of the match. Sheepy, take it away, because this was them pivoting on a dime.
I think this was such a strong team fight. Wolf is going in, hitting two people with his ultimate. And what you can see here as well is that he's standing so much in front, and Rumble, perfect follow-up, and then the ultimate from Kalista, that is just such an on-point communication. And they had so much pressure, and then was Bang coming in, slowly pulling more and more pressure, and EDG is still all alive, and then everyone just dies.
That was the orbital ion cannon from, like, off-screen.
Yeah.
From Martin.
You have to note, this is a composition that can eliminate the backline without even looking at it. An equalizer with a Vladimir ulti immediately gets the backline out of the fight. Tristana has to rocket jump away. Lulu has to get out of there because she's cooking up. Like, yeah. And they didn't even use spells on them when they died.
I want to get Spawn in here on this one here.
I just want to point out, like, the entirety of that fight, Deft is free hitting and doing nothing. Like, he was an absolute non-factor in that whole fight. And I definitely agree with you guys. It was well coordinated, well set up. But by that time, the game had kind of already ran away with itself. They could have probably whiffed the equalizer. Like, Vlad ulted no one, and Easy Hoon still would have cleaned up the rest of the fight. The communication's on point, but EDG need to fix their early game.
Well, but that's interesting you point out the early game, because we saw EDG capitalize on the blown flashes with the visits to the top lane. It was the bottom players, you know, the bottom lane support and AD carry, to capitalize on flashes. So they were putting a lot of pressure on the map with that Sejuani, but even so, didn't equate to an early enough lead given the CS disadvantage between the AD carries.
I feel like EDG played a really good early game, visiting the top lane and getting the first blood there. And I really liked as well how it was following up afterwards. What was happening was Koro was getting a lead over Marin, and Bang was getting a lead over Def, both around 10 to 15 to 20 CS. And then you just had the game going 2 versus 2, 1 versus 1, SKT actually initiating lane swaps afterwards. And what happened after 18 minutes was that Koro was still with a 15 CS lead, but Bang was actually 45 CS ahead, and Def was so far behind that he was a non-factor.
You know, yeah.
And you talked about the very, very early part where they got the kill top. Then they followed all the way through the jungle. Bengi's looking at the blue. He got screwed early game. They're like, we're showing up at your red. He was able to smite it away, and Easy Hoon's ghost on the Vladimir really picked them up and into that fight. And I thought that was just kind of a misplay there by EDG because they had an advantage that they didn't push.
Well, we'll definitely be looking for EDG to step it up individually because that's what we gave them so much praise for going into this tournament. But SKT, a solid display from a team play standpoint, and as you mentioned, of course, Bengs Kalista being absolutely stellar. And that's going to do it here for this game. Don't touch that browser. When we return, we'll dive into our seventh match, which pits AHQ against Besiktas Esports Club. The action continues in just a few minutes.
This is the matchup we finally get to see. Number one China versus number one Korea.
Oh, level one rocket jump. Aggressive play. Beautiful playback here as well. Wolf going down solo. He's burning. First blood.
That's another kill picked up. Now Devin wants it. Knocks it back. Still can't get the kill. Izihun picks up one for the team.
As Mako looking to try and catch onto a Bengi, but not even sure whether he wants to do that one. As EDG are just melting. Bang. Beautiful ultimate from Clearlup. Look at the equalizer in the backside, though. On top of the Hemo Plague as well. This is what this comp's supposed to do.
SK Telecom T1, 2-0 on the day so far.